black girl, don't lie to me. Tell me, where did you sleep last night? In the pines, where the sun never shines. I wish you were the whole night too.
Okay, folks, welcome to another edition of Record Trap. My name is David Parsons. I am joined by my good friend, Justin Farrar. Justin, how's it going?
Good to see you. It's going well. Hi, David. It's good to see you again.
Yeah, good to see you, too. We are, last time we talked, we were talking about the Beatles and drugs, and I feel like this is a related conversation in some way. Because just to start us out, we were thinking that this time we would talk about the occult and the idea of the occult in popular music, in American music. I mean, there's so many branches of it, but a lot of it, just to introduce for folks that are following along at home, Justin and I took a look at a book that you recommended, actually. It's called Season of the Witch, How the Occult Saved Rock and Roll. This book is by Peter Bebergal. I think that's how you pronounce it. I hope that's how you pronounce it.
It might be Bebergal.
Bebergal.
Yeah, we're close, obviously.
We're close. We're getting close. So it's Bebergal, and I will link this book in the episode description so everyone can check it out if you want. But what this book is about is sort of, it's kind of a mega thesis about not just rock and roll, but actually the history of American music, which I find a very compelling idea that the occult or a kind of relationship to the other side in some way is a persistent theme in the history of American popular music, going all the way back to, you know, the Mississippi Delta blues that is the alleged, you know, origin story of American blues and rock and roll and all that stuff. But, you know, the occult also in music for us, I think, and correct me if I'm wrong with your experience, Justin, but I was first made aware of sort of this occult connection with rock and roll through being a kid in the 1980s and witnessing a kind of hysteria about Ozzy Osbourne and heavy metal music. And I had two cousins who were a little bit older than me who were really into like Iron Maiden and Slayer, and they had all these scary posters on their wall of devils and demons and all that kind of shit. And I was a little too young for it. So I was always honestly like scared of heavy metal, scared of that stuff. But this book was great. And I can read a few sections as we move through this. But when were you ever aware of like the devil in the music? Because it seems like to me, it seems now like ubiquitous. It's this book actually made me aware of how common a theme it is.
Yeah, we've had the 21st century has seen a string of occult influenced movements in music. It's come back in a big way. You know, like in the early 2000s, there was freak folk, free folk. I know everyone argues about whatever that term was, you know, that psychedelic indie folk scene. And there was a lot of occult stuff there. And then most recently, we've had this spiritual jazz revival, which has been incredible, which is, you know, a kind of black occultism. You know, with Kamasi Washington or Kamasi Washington and Angel Bat Dawid, you know, it's more of like a cosmic consciousness idea, but that would be a kind of, you know, it is, it's like an African-American occult spirituality influence.
I'm thinking about a Flying Lotus too. I don't know if you've heard.
Yeah. Well, he's buddies with Kamasi Washington, I believe. Kamasi Washington. Yeah. There's that rich LA scene where electronics and spiritual jazz are kind of overlapping.
Love that.
Oh, it's an amazing scene. I can't get enough of it. For me, I mean, I'm trying to think, you know, I think there's probably two starts for me is maybe partially before the music or maybe an offshoot of the music is my mom had occult books. In fact, she had this one that scared the living hell out of me. I have it with me. It's volume 9 of Man, Myth, and Magic, with this insane picture of Medusa. Yeah. That's my scribbling. That's my crayon scribbling on the front. I tried to blot her out.
That's a scary book.
Very scary. I mean, you know, funny, I look back, well, there's, you know, we could go into it. There's some funny synchronicities with this book that influenced me decades later that I was looking at this thing and I was like five or six. So my mom, being kind of a hippie-ish music person, had some of this stuff because, you know, obviously the 70s was like the decade for occultism. It just exploded. And this was kind of like, this series was kind of, I would kind of, describe this as like the 70s darker precursor to, remember that Time Life one that was a little more new age looking with silver covers? There was one about ancient, you know, all this stuff that we just hear about all the time now. Potential aliens building pyramids, psi research.
The 70s are like the moment for all of this stuff. And you and I were both born in the 70s, right? Mm-hmm. And sort of like born in this cultural stew that we didn't really become aware of until a little bit later. It's funny, I think that I didn't have scary occult books around my house. I think the scary occult book that's in most houses, American houses, is the Bible. Like, right? Because it's like, when you're a kid, you don't know. You know, these stories are freaky. Yeah. And you know, I don't discount the quality of the scary book being present in your house as sort of a driver of the imagination when it comes to a lot of this stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. And well, that's interesting that I could go off on a tangent on interesting bestsellers, because I think they come out of the 70s, right? Like, I mean, they're kind of Christian oriented, but, you know, books like the original The Exorcist, that, you know, what the movie's based on, the Amityville Horror. Horror book, these paperbacks that sold just millions and millions.
How about Communion?
Yeah, Communion's a big one.
Whitley Strieber. That's probably the scariest book I own, honestly, because of the cover of that book, which was like a million. And you talk about bestsellers.
Yeah.
Like, that's a book that would have been sold in the grocery store. And it has just this terrifying image on the cover that if you read the book, it becomes even scarier because it's like an image that he sort of channeled in like a hypnotic experience, and it's freaky as fuck. It's just a gray alien. It's like actually the like archetypal gray,
the classic
alien.
Gray.
Yeah, but books like that I try to like not even have like visible around my bookshelf, because they, I don't know, I do, I mean, I guess that's part of what I would want to ask you, Justin. Sort of like, how spooky and occult a guy are you? Because I sort of like, I don't know, I don't have any like occult practices that I necessarily have engaged in, and yet that sort of vision of an other side, or what this author in this book Season of the Witch calls the occult imagination, has definitely played a role in my life. I don't know about you.
Yeah, and just to comment on that briefly, I think the way he words that imagination is great, because we could get bogged down in there's a cult and then there's Satanism. There's real occult, and then there's crazy conservative parents calling anything a cult just to kind of control young American youth.
Yeah, what is a cult? I think that's a good question.
Yeah, and so I think Bebergal does a really great job of calling it in an imagination.
Yeah,
and, you know, because then he can kind of talk about the alarmist movements, as well as someone like David Bowie, who is genuinely practicing occult, playing out occult ideas in his music. Mm-hmm. And so it can span a range of things. You know, it can be, you know, alien stuff. It could be the spiritual jazz, or we could talk about occult proper, like Crowley, obviously, his mm-hmm. influence on Jimmy Page and Zeppelin. So yeah, I think it's cool to keep it a bit loose, because I think in pop culture and music, everything's in play there. You know, there's not a ton of people in that world, as Bebergal really points out, who are like, you know, outside of like, you know, Throbbing Gristle or some of the more underground bands who are very into very specific occult magic practices. Mm-hmm. A lot of the metal bands, they're just kind of mixing things up. And,
right,
you know, right. I mean, Ozzy kind of always insisted that I'm not really into the occult. I'm into horror movies.
Well, you know? I mean, it's funny. I know I've brought up the Red Hot Chili Peppers many times over the years because I'm an unapologetic Chili Peppers fan. But like, even just listening to their stuff after reading this book, Season of the Witch, I'm hearing all this, like, you know, they have songs like Parallel Universe, you mm-hmm. know, and everything's about, and The Other Side. And it's all, there's not a specific occult practice attached to this stuff. Instead, it's sort of the spirit of rock and roll is this like sort of, I don't know, quasi mystical kind of set of ideas. Some bands engage in it directly, but there's also just that wider concept that I guess you would call the occult imagination mm-hmm. that's here. I could read just a quick section of yeah. this introduction to get us attached to the at least the rock and roll part of this. What Bebergal says in his introduction is this: rock is the sound of both spiritual and musical rebellion. And for the long and continuing history of this most indispensable of musical forms, these two things have become inseparable. What is it about rock, more than any other art form of the modern age, that makes it such a perfect vehicle for this ancient and often unconscious drive to penetrate the veil between the phenomenal world and the numinous realm of the spirit? Why have so many musicians staged their rock concerts to appear as moments of shamanic and religious rites, and created personas simulating magicians, demons, the gods Pan and Dionysus, even appearing as people possessed by gods or devils or worse? Why have they covered their album covers with images of the occult, conjured their lyrics out of the stuff of legend and myth, and even in their personal lives sought their own mystical and magical experiences? Why have they performed shows in front of ancient relics? So that's a little section of Peter Bebergal's Season of the Witch, How the Occult Saved Rock and Roll. It made me think of like kind of like breaking on through to the other side as sort of a mission statement of rock and roll, right? And in this book seemed to convince me that at least since the 60s, that's been a big sort of driving mega theme behind the behind all the different manifestations, I guess, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and I think, like, as he points out, you could even rewind it back to, you know, the hoodoo tradition, which is, you know, of African-American culture, and how, mm-hmm. I mean, if you go into the blues and early rock and roll, there's so much mention. It's funny because you grow up hearing these words and you don't pay attention to them. And then when you study hoodoo, you're like, oh, wait a minute. They're talking about hexes and charms and curses. You know, there's that one, I'm a Hoochie Coochie Man, the Muddy Water song, where mm-hmm. he yells out, I've always been obsessed with this. He yells out Johnny Conqueror. And you're like, well, what is that? And then you look it up and that's a root. That is a root used in hoodoo charms, you know, to mm-hmm. usually, I think with that one, I don't want to butcher this, but I think that one's often used in like, to win over somebody's love or something like that. You know, mm-hmm. hoodoo has this interesting thing of like being highfalutin in some ways, a very spiritual practice. But then there's like, you light a candle if you want money.
Right.
You know,
Right.
Which is, you know, and I think that high and low thing mm-hmm. is kind of runs throughout what we're talking about here into the 60s, into the 70s, where on one hand you can have like, again, David Bowie, but then you can have Motley Crue doing Shout at the Devil, you know, which gets to the, when you were wondering about like maybe the first Sonic thing for me, it was playing Shout at the Devil backwards on the record. I mean, I totally played records backwards as much as
I was going to ask you that. I've never done that. I assumed you had done that at some point.
Oh, I was way into playing records backwards. Like there's that song on Shout at the Devil called God Bless the Children of the Beast. It's ridiculous. It's like a minute half long acoustic solo where they just then at the end just sing in harmony, God bless the children of the beast. You know, these guys, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, Motley Crue are ridiculous, but they're, you know, they know what kids wanted in the mid 80s. And also it's a great way to buy more copies, right? If you're just scratching the records up, if they tell you to play it backwards, then you scratch it up and then you got to go out and buy another copy.
Well, this is like part of the like urban legend element of rock and roll that was very present, I feel like, when we were young. The kind of hearing rumors that so-and-so sacrificed animals and killed babies. And I mean, the rumor mill was huge before the internet. I don't know where this stuff came from. I mean, it's kind of incredible to think about how rumors like that became so huge that they almost became fact for people that this had happened, you know, someone had done this on stage or something like that. But there's also like that rumor of like the underbelly of like, yeah, there's secret messages in all of the music.
Back masking.
Wasn't that part of the hysteria?
Exactly.
Back masking.
Yeah. So like it's this funny feedback loop, right? Like bands might've been putting some stuff in there. I mean, there are like, you know, like when you listen to the end of Strawberry Fields, like there really is that weird voice buried in there. It actually, you know, where you know, someone said I forget the whole thing because I was into that too. I was literally looking at Magical Mystery Tour in the mirror, trying to see what the large stars might have spelled something out for Paul is Dead.
You can do that with Led Zeppelin 4 too, right? Like if you hold the big figure, that's if you unfold the LP. And hold it up to a mirror, it's just one figure of a statue, like I think it's the Hobbit from the Hobbit, but if you hold it up to a mirror, it forms a dog's face, and people say that's like the black dog from let's say there's all sorts of stuff like that throughout the history of this particular. I guess I think the 70s are just such a critical moment for this, like this whole idea of like the magic in the rock and roll. Mm-hmm. It makes sense, I guess, because it's like you know, I don't want to be too much of the like nostalgia trap historian of the 60s or whatever, but it feels like, I don't know, that there was a political revolution in the music in the 60s. And by the time you get to the 70s, it's like a spiritual revolution. And that's just like a very general sort of thrust,
and it turns quite dark.
Yeah, totally.
You know,
satanic.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah, and you know, Zeppelin is an interesting case because now there's a case where, you know, Page he's a serious student of magic. And so Eric Davis, who we both really like, he wrote Technosis and High Weirdness. He wrote a little book on Led Zeppelin. I think Led Zeppelin 4 for that 33 and a third series.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know he wrote one of those.
Yeah, he did. It's fantastic. And I saw him give a talk about it. And in the song Remains the Same, there's the part, you know how Page plays the guitar with the bow,
mm-hmm.
you know, and well, in that, Eric breaks down that he's doing a magic ritual on stage. He takes the bow and he points in the four directions before he does the solo and everything. And so, you know, Eric's like, he knows all that stuff. And so he just broke it out. He goes, you know, the crowd is getting whipped up and they love it. And they just think it's like maybe just this ritual thing. But like, he actually showed you how it was like a little magic ritual right before they launches into it, using the bow to honor the, you know, the four directions, the four elements, you know, that kind of stuff.
Right. Yeah. And I mean, it's funny. I grew up thinking that those bands were later than the Beatles, but they were like sort of at the same time, right? Like Led Zeppelin is doing stuff in the late 60s, and so is Black Sabbath. Like, and Ozzy has songs that are like literally about like Mr. Crowley and like, you know, like very directly about this occult tradition. I mean, there's that element of it, but there's also, it's funny, there's just like the idea of music itself as a kind of gateway to the other side, whether it be about the occult or not. I don't know if you ever, I read this book, I think, I was thinking about it today because I was thinking about the different, I don't know, stuff about the occult and the paranormal that I've read. And there's this book by Michael Crichton, the guy that wrote Jurassic Park.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a nonfiction book, like a kind of a memoir called Travels.
Mm-hmm.
That's totally a 70s book. It's just him, it's stories of him trying to like apply his rational medical doctor mind to all of this paranormal activity. And he goes around the world talking to psychics and everything. And he actually becomes far less of a skeptic by the end of the book. He's like believes in a lot of this stuff, or at least he has a more open mind about it. But one of the things that he describes in the book is this this dude that was like lots of, he goes to a lot of different like 70s cult like gurus and people like that, a lot of California. It's very inherent vice. What is it, like Chris Skylodon, like that type of shit.
Mm-hmm.
New age people doing all sorts of weird shit. There was this one dude that was like, his therapy, his new age therapy was sort of have everyone lay down in like a gym and gymnasium or like a big floor. And he had gigantic speakers and he played like vinyl of like anything. He would play anything. Literally, he'd play like Jesus Christ Superstar. You know, he would play, 50s rock and roll, any kind of music, but just at maximum volume. And people would lay on the floor with their eyes closed, and he would sort of like encourage them to like get lost in the visions. And I did this, dude. After I read Travels, I did this where I like laid on the floor. I was living in the San Fernando Valley. It was right after 9/11. I was definitely in a seeking phase. But we had a gigantic old speaker system and a turntable, and I played the song by Roy Orbison, "Crying." Right, like that song. It's like got a beat that's like boom, boom, boom. Boom, 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 boom. And I played it at maximum volume, laying on the floor. And yeah, I mean, I'll be damned if I didn't have like a psychedelic experience listening to that song. And it makes me think about the sort of power of music beyond the occult property that's like actually, you know, directly in the music, the way that, you know, Ozzy's singing about Aleister Crowley. Instead, it's more like that magic that like David Lynch has in like 50s songs. They're just like totally fucking haunted, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Do you understand what I'm talking about, Justin? That sort of like haunted feeling of music, because music can be really scary and powerful. I guess that's what I'm sort of getting at.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think the 50s has some of the most haunted music of all time.
Right.
I mean, the one that I always go to, which I guess is pretty timely, is Elvis's version of Blue Moon from the Sun recordings,
mm-hmm.
which he, you know, there's the uses a reverb that it sounds like a horse.
Blue Moon, you saw me standing alone without a dream in my heart. Without a love of my own. Blue moon, you knew just what I was there for. You heard me saying a prayer for someone I really could care for.
Like there are certain songs that I think that we have never caught up with, like they're from a future that we will never reach, and that
he sounds like he's underwater.
Yeah,
in that.
Yeah. Like on a planet, like a distant planet or something. It's yeah, I mean it's very kind of spacey and cosmic. At the same time, it's just this young Southern kid doing a song that probably took just a couple hours with some reverb on it.
It makes me wonder if anyone's used that in a movie or TV show, because it's like maximum haunting. I think
it is.
It's funny because so many filmmakers have used 50s mm-hmm. music in kind of that counterpoint mm-hmm. way, right? To be like, Lynch is probably
Lynch
the one that's
is,
most famous for taking songs that might have been like sort of like, I don't know, happy pop songs of the 50s, and instead now I'm like horrified by whatever is going on and that sort of thing. But yeah, it feels like a pretty common idea. It's making me think of like the first time I'd seen that maybe is in this episode of X-Files called Home, where there's
I know the one you're talking about.
Yeah, it's like this group of like inbred zombies.
That's right. Yeah. The family in the house.
Yeah, it's like in the house.
It's
horrifying. Yeah. But there's a scene where these zombies are like murdering some people, and they put like a 50s song mm-hmm. to it. And I remember being like a teenager watching this on a Friday night, and it was just maximum spooky because of that haunted nature of that particular era of music. And yeah, God, Blue Moon. That Elvis recording. I think a lot of the Sun Records mm-hmm. stuff, the early Elvis stuff, has a very haunted kind of feeling to it, to me.
It sure does. And I think the thing about music too, when we're talking about its general properties, is I think it's kind of interesting. Like I think about this a lot. Is like you have of all the arts, it's the one that kind of it goes beyond boundaries the most. Like say you live in a big city, you can know what your neighbor is listening. You know what your neighbor likes in terms of music. You don't know what's on their walls necessarily in terms of visual art. You don't know what books are on the bookshelf. I mean, of course, if you know them, but you know what their record collection is. Or like, you know, when you think about the city, you know, you have the city divided up into ethnic enclaves or class divisions, obviously, you know. But the one thing that passes beyond those things, kind of like a specter, is music. Somebody could drive by in a car and you're hearing what they're listening to, you know. I mean, I know that there's some other things you can maybe go see some spoken word or you could see murals. You know, obviously a mural is a wonderful piece of public art, but I don't think it does quite the same thing. Music has a spectral quality that it literally passes through walls. And I've always been fascinated by that with music.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I've been annoyed by that too. with listening to neighbors' music. I mean, honestly, like the sound, it's funny you say that because New York City, like I've lived for several years in Washington Heights in New York City, which is a neighborhood that's primarily like people from the Dominican Republic. And like, it was reggaeton mm-hmm. is the sound of that neighborhood. I mean, just loud, that beat, which is like the beat under every reggaeton song, became like the almost like the pulse of the neighborhood to me. Yeah. Like at a certain point, I didn't even hear it anymore. And now I think I'd be shocked by what it would sound like to me, because I sort of just got accustomed to it. Like that became my heartbeat too, living in that neighborhood. And it's funny because you move somewhere else and you don't hear it anymore. Like it's like there are definite sounds to whole neighborhoods that maybe are the thing I remember the most. You know, you talk about like mm-hmm. a spectral presence. Like that's the thing I remember the most.
Yeah,
I don't know. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I think that sound of the neighborhood, I think there's an interesting record, which is not overtly a cult, but is Miles Davis's On the Corner, you know, which would be obviously become a huge influence on hip hop because of the way it would, the tape splicing and the loops. But it sounds like a street corner. It sounds like the streets.
I love that album, but I don't really know much about it. What makes it different from other Miles Davis?
It's recordings? Probably the one where he and his producer, who deserves a lot of credit, Teo Macero, it's probably the one where they get the most out in terms of the loops and using, I mean, things are just looped almost like they would be in dance music or hip hop a decade later. And so mm-hmm. it has this incredible hypnotic sound. And it also, it just like what you were saying, it has the pulse of a street, like the car, like when you listen to the band, that it's not just a band, it's that one horn becomes the car passing by. You know,
right,
another
right.
sound is the sound of the fire hydrant broken and spraying water into the street. There's a little percussion that sounds like children playing by that fire hydrant.
Sort of like the atmospheric yeah. music of the world. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's groovy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely. But, yeah, to get back to that darkness. I don't know. You know, I was thinking, yeah, I was thinking about my own experiences there. And I guess I was going to segue back into that. I don't know. There's just so much to talk about, really. It's almost like my brain is crackling with all these ideas.
I know. I threw that throughout the Roy Orbison crying idea. You know, it's funny that idea just came from the Michael Crichton book, you know, of like, you know, these 70s new age people
yeah.
who were, I mean, really into these ideas, but it's, I think of them as like, sort of like, this is like when white people discover all this stuff and start to like, try to connect directly with the divine in some way that religion has failed them. There's that part of the story, but I don't know. One thing that really struck me about the book is sort of thinking about the longer history of this stuff, and like the fact that like the occult itself in America, like just Americans into the occult, their version of it comes from African traditions and comes from European traditions. And I'm like, well, that's basically American popular music mm-hmm. too. And in fact, like this guy, Peter Bebergal, like convinces you that that's not an accident. Like those two things are connected. Like the sort of occult ideas come through the music in often really surprising ways. And I'm thinking about the sort of Delta blues mm-hmm. thing and sort of black people who are enslaved bringing traditions from Africa, including the instruments, mm-hmm. right? Like including like stringed instruments.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Which are, you can go on YouTube and see some of these like stringed instruments that are sort of kind of like guitars, kind of like banjos.
The banjo the banjo essentially comes from Africa, like when you take it back.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then like that intersecting with like what we call white people now in like Appalachia mm-hmm. and like their particular like Scottish folk songs, right? Like those two things colliding, creating a kind of I don't know, syncretic musical form that eventually makes its way in through like up through Kansas City and then electrifies in Chicago with like Howlin' Wolf. All of it to me is a progression that is connected to this sort of like I don't know, this sort of mixture of cultures that's happening in America. Like it's like all of this could have only happened here in some ways.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, yeah, you know, it's a funny thing. It's very tricky because it, you know, there's the appropriation thing, which is obvious, but then there is this kind of, and I would never, I mean, clearly cultural appropriation, yes, on the table, bam, but there's also this occultish idea that we're talking about where music just cannot be contained. You know, a
right.
perfect example would be in the South, the lines, the political lines of from slavery to segregation, mm-hmm. who can move where, who can go into what room, who has control of whose body, all this thing, all this control over movement. But the music never follows that. It cannot, because it's spectral. It literally will just pass beyond any kind of a political mm-hmm. law about movement and interaction that you could create.
Right, right. Yeah, that idea to me is really a critical
mm-hmm.
one. And so it's funny because you talk about appropriation. My dad just saw the Elvis movie. My dad's really into mm-hmm. Elvis, you know. And he's right now, he's kind of, his mind is blown by the idea that so many white people hated Elvis for doing black music, right?
They did.
And I was like, that's, and for bringing black music to white people, right? And like making their white teenage daughters be into this sort of expression, which was identified as like an African-American musical expression and also like a way of moving the body. And there's a sexualization there. I mean, there's a lot going on. But my dad's focus is entirely like on, wow, I can't believe all these white people that were reactionaries and like they were racist and they hated Elvis because he was doing black music. And that's totally in tension with like an idea I hear today, which is that, well, Elvis actually is the racist because he stole black music and appropriated it. And I find it, to me, I can hold both of those ideas in my head and think like they're both those things can be, I can see the validity of and the value of like kind of pursuing those avenues. But it's really, really interesting to me that all of it is still sort of litigated through this exactly what we're talking about, sort of where is the music in all of that? You know, because the music itself is something that almost weirdly transcends a lot of those sort of those conversations about
it's
power,
the ghost. It's the ghost always just moving and changing and morphing and passing through whatever onto whatever else it goes to.
Well, think about like, you know, the original, like the Hound Dog song, right, is Big Mama Thornton, who is a woman who's like a blues singer who has like an incredible power in her voice. And the song was written for her explicitly. It was meant to be her like big song. And it was her like her big song just like 2 years before Elvis does a version of it on Ed Sullivan, the famous Hound Dog version of it that Elvis did on Ed Sullivan in 56. That's the one that, like, you know, people were upset about because he was shaking his hips, etc. Like, that's, I think that's part of what people talk about when they talk about sort of this concept of appropriation or
it's interesting. And at the same time, it's interesting because there's leading up to that moment, there is a lot of black influence on white religion, on white music, but it didn't break through. You know, there's that 50s, something happened in the 50s, but you know, if you rewind like Jimmy Rogers in the early 20th century, going back to the 20s, I mean, he based his whole, you know, he's the father of country music. He was totally influenced by black blues players. And so, and then, you know, I sent you that other thing, which I thought was really interesting. I wish I could remember the name. I'm going blank, but there's this great, documentary from the early 80s about, Appalachian religion. And there is the opening footage in there is the Reverend Bobby Akers. Bobby Akers is a guy in Virginia. The congregation is all white. And they are playing the most intense gospel rock and roll music. I mean, and you can see completely, you know, completely white mountain. I believe it's Baptist, but the music, the entire worship is based on, goes back. You can follow all the way back to, African religion. All the way back to the slaves and then back to Africa. I mean, it's mind blowing footage. It's Pentecostalism essentially. I think I could be mixing a few things up here because I get a little confused with some of those offshoots and, you know, kind of the denominations. But the guy, like they're playing hard boogie woogie gospel music. And it's a real eye opener because that had been going on the whole time. I mean, it had gone back well before even that rock and roll as a pop phenomenon occurred.
Yeah, it seems like a critical ingredient in all of this is church music or music associated with religion, and then the bridge out of that. Like, and in a lot of ways, I mean, rock and roll ends up being this sort of secular religious music, if that makes sense, of the United States. And I think, like, I don't know, I put hip-hop in with rock and roll as sort of, I don't know the divisions between those things necessarily. I mean, obviously we can talk about form and we can talk about race, we can talk about a lot of different things, but to me, like, those are tandem sort of They're both sort of, to me, both musical forms are achieving a similar thing in that they're sort of aiming at a kind of escape and a kind of sonic escape. I don't know. I'm thinking about like the people talk a lot about when they're talking about the history of American music, the sort of call and response. And he talks about it in his book, actually, too. Mm-hmm. So like call and response and like the form of singing that enslaved people were expressing in the South during the 18th and 19th centuries and those things sort of making their way in and out of church. And that sort of like field, the sort of field music versus church music and those sort of things happening at the same time. But there's also one thing I read that like really blew my mind is that there were a lot of enslaved people, I think about 30%, who were black Muslims in the South during the antebellum period, who were, you would have heard in the South these sorts of prayers that were Islamic prayers that are a very different kind of singing and a very different kind of like emoting. You can, I can put an example in the episode description of like what this sounds like because, and I'm sure people maybe already know what it sounds like, but it's really, really interesting because it's another element, like it's another ingredient in this sort of mix of things that are going to be present in popular music all the way to today, which is a sort of, I don't know, it's a style of vocalization that is really spiritual and emotional and different than a lot of other types of singing that you've heard, and it becomes totally recognizable in American rock music. The like, I don't know, you think about like Robert Plant and Led Zeppelin, sort of his insane rock and roll wail. There's something religious about it, if that makes sense. You know, there's something really like I don't know, over the top and melodramatic in the expression that seems like it's tapping into something really, really archaic and ancient. I don't know.
Yeah, I think that, well, you know, Led Zeppelin is a perfect, like, when we're talking about the intersection of the black music traditions and black spirituality, and then the white occult traditions. Led Zeppelin's a perfect intersection of those. Cause I mean,
they're a blues band, right?
And they're straight up ripping off the blues on certain songs. I mean, you know, not giving people certain credit. I mean, they were such bandits with that stuff. But yeah, I mean, Jimmy Page, here's this guy who's buying Crowley ephemera, who has this deep knowledge of, the occult, and then they're a blues band. You know, they're just, I mean, you know, no blues, no Led Zeppelin. And that wail, I think that wail goes back. I mean, obviously Robert Johnson is a huge influence, but I also think, you know, there's some other ones he mentions too, when he talks about the myth of the crossroads,
Let's talk about Robert Johnson. I mean, yeah. Robert Johnson, someone I always kind of heard of. I think it was a friend of mine in college eventually like had a CD, and I'd heard this legend of the crossroads and everything, but like I got, like when I was 18 years old or 19, whenever this dude put the CD on for me, I was like, I don't get it. I don't understand, you know? And yet you can like watch like a billion different interviews with all these different musicians, and they're all like, Robert Johnson is who started it all, man. Mm-hmm. Robert Johnson is the guy, you know? And so like, what is, for people that don't understand, now I think I get it a little bit more, but why is Robert Johnson such a critical figure in all of this? Because it seems like, I mean, in this book even, he's even undermining the whole idea of like the devil story even being a part of Robert Johnson's actual mythology. There were other blues musicians
who
played it up.
Who is amazing. More. I mean, if you want to hear a totally ghostly voice, Tommy Johnson is it's unreal. Him and Skip James. I think like if anybody wants to hear ghostly blues music, like just midnight, dead of night, ghostly blues music, it's Tommy Johnson and Skip James. They're it.
Outside is hearing it rain. Where you go? Times are harder than ever been before. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. drifting from door to door, but they can't find no heaven. I don't care where they go.
There's a great little book about Robert Johnson from Peter Guralnik talking about how, you know, there's obviously timing with his influence. The fact that there's very little biographical data, like hard data. We don't know, you know, there's like very almost like basic things about his life missing. You know, they have guesses and, you know, they can get around, you know, there were people who knew him.
We know he's part of the 27 Club, speaking of like the occult and the devil in the music, is like he died at 27 years old, along with a million other rock musicians. And there's allegedly some sort of key to that. I don't know what it is, but just that rock musicians live on the edge. I mean, he does in the book that he talks a little bit about that, right? Is that there is this sort of like rock music has an edge to it. And I would say that matches pretty well with the blues. Like the blues is an outsider thing. The people who are doing it are sort of like down and out people. And that's in jazz as well. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of, I mean, Charlie Parker was like 34 when he died. I mean, there's a lot of tragedy there too. I mean, that's a whole other show maybe. In some respects, but I think it links with this idea of the occult, or the idea of music being a kind of place that dances with the other side. Mm-hmm. And if you're a musician that's really skilled at doing that, you're a skilled person at like being on the other side for whatever that means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was just kind of digesting that.
Robert Johnson, that shit scares the shit out of me now. Like now when I listen to it, I'm like, oof, like I get it. I get what's spooky.
That's interesting you say that, because I had been, you know, I mean, I fully soaked that up years ago, but I don't know, about a few weeks ago, I put it on like while falling asleep. And I woke up about an hour later, like an hour later.
What kind of dreams are you going to have with
that?
Yeah,
and it was still going.
Scared, yeah.
And it is, I mean, I think some of it also has to do with the fact that he's just, he's just so good. I mean, I'd hate to say something that's kind of unquantifiable in a way. I wish I could say something more concrete, but, you know, you listen to a lot of other blues artists, his style is just so unique. He's perfect. I think that's something, and I think that's something kind of interesting. Like when you look at a guy like, Little Richard, or Elvis, somebody that people might listen to more, they represent a kind of almost perfection of something, a synthesis of things delivered in just an almost perfect form. And I think Robert Johnson is that way. There's a lot of amazing Delta blues artists. Again, like Skip James might even be more haunted sounding. But when you talk about all the different ingredients coming together to create that form, Robert Johnson has it. And, you know, and at the same time, we have to say, like, there is a kind of interesting kind of shaping of his myth there, because when you listen to his full catalog, there's actually a bunch of stuff that's not Delta blues at all. I mean, he does stuff that's almost more jug band. And, I mean, he has a pop element. And I think that's kind of an underrated thing. I think with Delta blues, we want it to be this authentic thing, right? Like this is the guy that was down in the Delta, in the juke joint playing at 4 a.m., you know, and that could be true, but also Robert Johnson, it's clear he was listening to everything, and he, you know, like, and he almost had a magician's ability. And I think this is another angle in the occult. He almost had a magician's ability to synthesize things into just this perfected form. Much like, I keep mentioning Bowie, but I think he just looms over a lot of us, much like David Bowie would in the 70s, like bringing in all this different stuff from pop, stuff from blues, stuff he heard in church, stuff he heard out in the fields, in the juke joints, into this thing that sounded great on a record.
Yeah, it makes me think that a great song is a kind of magic trick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so many musicians talk about you know, that they didn't write the song sort of found mm-hmm. them, or they found the song, you know, and that, you know, when you're playing a song for someone, you're sort of giving them an experience in one way or another. I don't know. I'm thinking about the line between Led Zeppelin and Robert Johnson, but also the line from like Nirvana to Robert Johnson, because and to that style of blues and that tradition, because I think Justin Rogers Cooper, on our good friend Justin Rogers Cooper was on the show. You know, he's on the show all the time. But years ago, he went on some rant about In the Pines, mm-hmm. the song that Kurt Cobain sings at the Unplugged thing right before he died. I mean, people that know Nirvana, you know, that's sort of like this legendary moment for a lot of different reasons. But it makes me think of that like Whale, because at some point, like he like lets out like this carnal animal mm-hmm. scream in that song, and it's sort of like it always feels like a kind of goodbye to Kurt Cobain to me, weirdly enough. But I also feel deeply hit, like he's sort of saying goodbye through this like channeled moment that is a song that's kind of been passed along through American music, especially black blues music, for decades, maybe longer, and that it's like a really haunted song. I mean, this, you know, you just hear this like, you know, my girl, you know, don't lie to me, tell me, where did you sleep last night? And the answer you get is in the pines where the sun don't ever shine and I shiver the whole night through. Mm-hmm. There's something so vague about it. I mean, the song actually has a story to it. It's changed over the years and it's evolved. The song at one point had a lot more detail to it in terms of like a guy who fell off a train and there was an accident and there were people sleeping with each other. But what Cobain does, and I think I can't help thinking that he was sort of honoring this tradition, is stripped it down to this sort of like the vague elements of it, and it makes it even more haunting to me. And it's also, again, the like white dude that's like the pop guy carrying the message of like the underground in some way. There's so much going on there. I really appreciate that moment, in part because it sort of carries so much of the history we're trying to describe right now.
Yeah, I think that's a good touchstone. And I think that it's an interesting connection to something that really kind of looms over a lot of this, is the Harry Smith folk anthology.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the Harry Smith folk anthology. Harry Smith is an occultist, and there it is.
David is holding it up.
And
yep. I'm so glad you mentioned that, dude, because that's something that if we like stop recording in a few minutes here, and I was like, why didn't we mm-hmm. mention the Harry Smith? Because it really is. And this, before you even get started, for me, it was the Bob Dylan, like Martin Scorsese documentary. And maybe that was like late for you, but for me, I mm-hmm. didn't know about this until that documentary, which is actually a fantastic documentary for explaining a lot of this progression.
Oh, that's a fantastic,
gets into like the whole folk music thing. Because I think that's part of what I was getting at with Appalachia mm-hmm. and Elvis and black music, etc., is that that Appalachian folk music mm-hmm. is such a critical ingredient to all of this too. And it mixes with the blues. And I really, for me, I kind of mark that as the two main sort of streams of music that form rock and roll.
Right? Yeah. And with the folk anthology, I mean, for people who don't know Harry Smith, I mean, just very basic, is a New York bohemian. He also does animation. He's a collector of 78s. This is mid 20th century. So we're going back to the 50s again. And so he creates this folk anthology and for Smithsonian Folkways, the label, you know. And so instead of doing like just a regular archival box set, he collects all this stuff. There's black blues, white jug band. There's jug band music. There's string band music. There's everything on there. It's basically the Bible for the folk revivalists, for bringing back archaic folk music post-World War II. Because at that time, you know, nowadays, you know, we live in a kind of eternal present, right? Almost nothing seems old in a weird way. In the 50s, this stuff, even though it was recorded maybe just 30 years before, seemed like it was from another like another century. It just seemed like it was from a world that no longer existed. And so Harry Smith went about it. He was also an occultist, but so he creates this thing and it has all this occult imagery in it. I mean, it's a really, when you stand back and kind of leaf through it and look at it, the original box, it's a strange thing to do. He's doing what Jimmy Page would do years later with blues and mixing it with occultism. He's just,
you're talking about like this little catalog that comes with it, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
There's alchemy. Freaky, there's phrases from the alchemical tradition there. There's esoteric symbols. And so it's not a normal, it's not what you would expect from folkways, which is you open it up and you learn about, well, this music started here and then it passed through, you know, it's not anthropological in any traditional sense. It is a magical document in its own right.
It totally is. Yeah. Yeah. I'm so glad you mentioned it. Here's a little bit from our friend Greil Marcus from the introduction to The Old Weird America, which is a book that sort of takes on Harry Smith's anthology and connects it to Bob Dylan and connects it to 60s revolutionary music and that sort of stuff. But he says this, he says, it was no accident that the anthology was issued in 1952 at the height of the McCarthyist witch hunt. It was not irony that led Smith near the end of his life as a shaman in residence at the Naropa Institute in Boulder, Colorado, to record every sound he encountered in the course of a 4th of July, from speech to fireworks to crickets. In 1952, with the United States at war with Korea and resurgent at home, a world power and the envy of the world seeming complete and finished, Smith made his own country. Fucking great stuff from Greil Marcus. And that piece goes on and on. But yeah, the anthology, there are songs in there that have the same quality to me as the Robert Johnson recordings and the other stuff, right? Super spooky.
Doc Boggs is on there, who's one of Grail's favorites. And I wish I could remember Grail's lines. He says something like, Doc Boggs sounds as if, what does he say? The skin is like being pulled off his bones or something. You know, it's just extreme vision, and
yeah, he sounds like he's crying when he's singing. And there's also just like so many of these songs, like the Cuckoo Bird songs.
Very strange. What you said within the pines was great. Because like you listen, you like what are you talking about?
Oh, the cuckoo is a pretty bird. She warbles as she flies, she never hollers cuckoo till the 4th day July.
Totally. That is 100% the feeling. But it's also like it's a world, you know? Like it feels like when you listen to it, to me, like it's a movie almost, in the sense of like I can't square the like world that is being conjured by this song with the world that's in front of me in 2022. I have to like go to another place in order to sort of get through to it or understand it. Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's such a weird, that's really haunting
stuff.
It is.
And I wondered if we could tie it. It's interesting. I wonder if we could tie it with a bit of a tension between the occult and the left tradition. Which we both, you know, I think both of us probably have feet in a little bit of both, right? Like, I mean, I I'm a socialist, you know, I that's what I say, but I also know that a lot of people that identify them as socialists would look at me really strange if I started talking about occult stuff, right? And vice versa. I mean, I know a lot of occult people who like, they're into all weird stuff. And then when you ask them about politics, they're basically like, I'm a liberal. You know, they're like, you know, they don't have that same imagination. Mm-hmm. So I'm tying this to the box set, because what's very interesting about that box is that the original was this strange magical document. But when they reissued it, they removed all that. And they instead made it I'm forgetting the name, but you know the photographer who did all the very famous iconic Depression era photography. You know, you see the Dust Bowl photography.
Like Dorothea Lange.
It might be, but you know, just those harrowing black and white pictures of just families on the side of the road.
It sounds like they turned into a Ken Burns.
So they got rid of the magical stuff, and they turned it into like, you know, it was more of something that for the Pete Seeger crowd, which I'm not knocking.
They're like poverty produced this rich culture.
And so there's an anthropological kind of context and explanation for all this music. And then when they did the reissue again, because then it disappeared for years. And you could only get the second one was actually the one that more folkies got, because it was way more common to buy. The original magical document one was really like, if you found one of those, you were a serious record collector if you could, you know, scrounge one of those out of some dusty place. Then when they finally reissued it, they returned it to the magical document. And I guess this is my convoluted way of saying that there's an interesting tension there between the original and the reissue. That for me personally, and I know that you're probably similar, is like in the vision you have of a society, there's like the magical and the social mesh together somehow. And I mean, I know that's vague sounding, like, you know, I don't know how it would play out, but like that's kind of, you know, we talk about a way, like you mentioned acid communism once, you know, like there's this idea of the magical and the social in, I don't know. So I'm ranting, but I feel like that's an important thing.
No, I agree. It makes me think of the October 21st, 1967 levitating the Pentagon thing, right? It's like, this was the left. This was the anti-war movement. There were a lot of like socialists and communists and sort of like new left kids there and college kids, etc. And part of their contingent were people that were, I don't know, like partly tongue-in-cheek, but partly genuine, trying to like, you know, do some occult ritual to levitate the Pentagon and turn it into flowers in the sky sort of thing, which sounds so like ridiculous. And then you realize that like they're talking about something that was built as the Pentagon, right? Like, in other words, the state is doing occult stuff too, which is sort of a freaky part of this, you know, the sort of like Illuminati and all that sort of thing. But the elite occult part of it is interesting to me, because you just mentioned this sort of like idea of the versions of the anthology, the Harry Smith anthology. And it seems to me like the dividing line is like one version is like underground people given the anthology to other underground people. And we all understand this is like sort of some underbelly of American history that you're not supposed to know about. And then it becomes like elites are looking at it and they're like going to present it as like some, anthropological thing, very condescending, very sort of like, oh, look at what like America can produce, you know, in all of its misery, they can produce some songs for us, rather than seeing like presenting it as like part of the fabric of like, I don't know, the real America. I hate to use terms like that, but like the people, you know what I mean? Like, this is like, to me, occult practices are in part connected to, you know, you mentioned politics, are connected to a kind of real populism. You know, because there aren't big, powerful institutions that are occult, really, unless you're, I mean, the Catholic Church, that's a whole other argument, I guess. But the idea is that, like, there's sort of an underground popular element to it. And if you go, like, right now, like, I think most people would agree that there's something happening with the resurgent occult ideas now in popular culture, right? You mentioned music. I mean, I actually see quite a bit of it in hip hop and, like, the sort of Marilyn Manson style that like was present in the late 90s is around now too. I feel like that's connected to it. But I don't know. It feels like that when you go on YouTube right now and like look at tarot readings, like there are so many young people doing tarot readings. And like, it's like, I don't know, it feels like a kind of working class thing. It feels like a lot of people of color doing it. Like there are just a ton of black women doing like psychic stuff and tarot stuff. And you can feel sort of that, I don't know, that melding tradition of whatever America is is still there. Like, it's still bubbling there. That kind of, I don't know, that contact with, that direct contact with whatever the spiritual is, rather than going to church.
Yeah, there's been a hoodoo resurgence as well. There's a great podcast called the Witch Wave. Pam Grossman is a witch, and she's not hoodoo, but she's had a lot of hoodoo practitioners on as guests, and it's fascinating.
Yeah, you listen to all those like weird studies and some other podcasts, right? Like, there are what are some of those, and what are they talking about?
Yeah, they talk about all kinds of stuff, you know. Yeah, well, weird studies is very head culture, but it's all over. I mean, there's occult stuff. There's a lot of tarot. They're big into tarot.
Can I ask you this? You said head culture. Like, how does this intersect with, like, drugs? Because it seems like our last conversation was about psychedelic drugs. And it's, to me, like, there's a relationship there between drug culture and occult culture.
There is. Obviously, weed is one of the great unifiers of everything, isn't it?
I'm like, these are all, so what I'm saying is these are all stoners,
well, you
right?
know,
that's the unifying myth.
I don't know. I'm trying to think. It is, well, you know, I'm trying to think of something. I mean, it's weird. I think intuitively, I would want to say, right, without thinking about it much, yes, there's a connection. And at the same time, there is a little tension between, like, what we would consider a head in the 60s, 70s, as opposed to someone really into, like, more of an occult underground spiritual tradition. You know what I mean?
I almost think of those as like cultures, subcultures that are in tension with each other, weirdly enough. Even though I'm like, you know, they're each trying to access something similar. They might have similar musical tastes. These straw man figures I'm creating in my mind here. But I feel like psychedelic culture, which is so much of the overarching theme of rock and roll in the 60s and 70s especially, is touching this stuff too. It's like, sort of, you know, tune in, turn on, drop out isn't necessarily a cult, but it's close.
Yeah, I mean, I think, Eric Davis's book is a good, Technosis is a good introduction to kind of the ways that head culture and the occult intersected, particularly in relation to the development of technology. I mean, computer technology in the 20th century. I mean, it's just there, right? I mean, it's funny. We talk about this relationship with the occult and music, and yet, you know, if you go back, there's this great book called Radical Spirits by Anne Broad. It's spiritualism and women's rights in 19th century America. And, you know, that talks about, you know, I mean, I think this history has gotten a little more famous, or a little more notoriety over the past couple of years, but about, you know, people literally doing seances. I mean, the overlap between spiritualism in upstate central New York and abolitionism and suffragism. I mean, it's, you know, I think the academy didn't quite know what to do with that stuff for years. You know, I think that history got kind of, you know, just as it did in modern art, the occult roots of modern art got kind of edited out of the story, you know? Yeah.
Totally, dude. I just put up the episode on Nostalgia Trap with Alicia Puglianese, who... Yeah, she's one of the rare, like, academic historians that takes on like ghosts and paranormal activity and things like that. But there is, like, and I will mention this, but I'll also mention that I don't know a ton about it, but I've read about the sort of subculture in academia of, like, weirding the Civil War, weirding the Vietnam War. I think that's sort of something that was happening when I was getting. When I was in graduate school, but when I left graduate school, it got bigger in the last 10 years. The idea of sort of bringing in a lot of those ideas that have been written out as having any kind of explanatory power, even among people who are doing, like, American studies and, like, cultural stuff. It's, you know, no one wants to be Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis in Ghostbusters, relegated to the basement But that movie, that, you know, that movie is a good example to me of like the occult in pop culture, because, you know, like the character that Dan Aykroyd plays in that movie is totally supposed to be the wacky professor that's into paranormal
shit. And you know
shit,
his
right?
family history, think, right?
Yeah,
he's offspring of spiritualists.
He's totally into this stuff.
Yeah.
I didn't know that family history, but I know that he's like really into UFOs
up around seances
and paranormal stuff in real
life.
He
wrote the introduction, and here's another. There's this wonderful photographer, Shannon Taggart, who did a book on, there's this place called Lilydale in Western New York. It's in the Southern Tier, which if people don't know, the Southern Tier is the strip that borders Pennsylvania from, and it's Western New York. So that's all the way from Erie, Pennsylvania, just the border there over to about Binghamton maybe. And that was it was called the burned over district in the 19th century.
That's spooky territory
is,
to
it
me.
It is. It's, I love it down there. So I went to Lilydale last year.
To me, like, I just think of like the woods and like fucking Blair Witch Project shit out
and
there.
And so
honestly.
Lilydale is this weird little, it's not a, well, it is technically gated, but you can go there, but there it is a little town full of psychics. Like, you just go and you can, well, you can set up and schedule an appointment, or if they're taking walk-ins, you can knock on a door and get your, you know, some whatever psychic thing you want done, whatever tradition you're into.
How much have you done that in your life? Have you gone to psychics? Have you tarot readings?
Yeah.
Stuff like that?
Yeah. I mean, I will. Yeah. Well, it starts. I could get really weird and just mention briefly that. I mean, I've never had, in terms of really hardcore weird experiences, I'm not one of these person who has ever said, "Oh man, I had sleep paralysis and saw gray aliens and stuff." I'm kind of drunk.
I was going to ask if you'd ever seen a ghost, met a ghost.
Something weird happened once. It was during my time of playing records backwards. And
you opened
like
gateway,
that movie,
man.
The Gate. Remember that? I saw that in the movie theater. I was big into, because that was like, that was us. Mm-hmm. Was the like, oh,
well, Hellraiser too.
Yeah. I mean,
Jesus,
I was such
Christ.
I still am a horror fanatic, but
horror connected to metal music in the 80s as devil
and,
shit.
It's a freaky time.
Anyway, sorry, you saw.
Well,
a ghost.
I don't. Ultimately, this is always my thing with all this stuff. I don't know. Those three words are always, you know. I like
Me
to
too.
Keep it open.
Totally.
I can just tell you what the Me experience too. Was. I have to be a little quiet. I will say this: my wife, now she has had true, really amazing experiences, freaky experiences. Me, I'm a bit of a dry well, except. We were doing a lot of seances. It was me and like four or five boys from the neighborhood. So maybe I would say we're on the verge of puberty, which I know, you know, that might sound strange to say, but that's a big thing in that world. When you see ghosts and stuff, they always talk about like when you're on the verge of puberty, prepubescent, there's usually an uptick of paranormal activity. Yeah,
isn't
it's strange. I mean, well, you know, things are going through
super weird.
The body is going through incredible. I mean, you're going through a metamorphosis.
Yes.
So we were doing, say, you know, this is like you said, this is heavy metal. We're listening to Motley Crue, Maiden, Judas Priest. We're listening to all those songs that there's lawsuits about. You know, we're just, I grew up in a very working class heavy metal community. And so we're doing seances and Ouija a lot. And so we're doing seances, and we found the perfect spot in this basement in this house I lived in, this really dumpy, scary house, and this back storeroom. And we would do it with the lights off, maybe a little flashlight, a little handheld flashlight on with a, like a sheet over it to dim it. And we were working ourselves up into a state. I mean, it was ridiculous. We would do sleepovers and just do it all night long. Who do you want to contact? You know? It's funny, I'd never talked about this. And like outside of close friends. And So we're getting going. I can't remember who we're trying to contact at this point. And there is this sound. It's like a bang and a roar. And I don't know. If you were to ask me at the time, above this one dude, Jimmy, above his head was this just kind of white thing, almost like a giant mouth or face. And I don't know, you know, we all freaked out. Everyone insisted they saw it. I don't know. After that point, it then got ridiculous.
The collective hallucination.
Yeah, after that, it then got ridiculous, because then we thought we saw something in someone else's house. Like, we're like, oh, we wanted to go to Jimmy's house to reconvene and get like our wits, you know, to really ground ourselves. And then we're like, wait a minute, there's something in the window. And at that point, it was off the rails. I know that stuff was just hysteria. Then we went to church and got holy water. I mean, this is like Lost Boys. It's ridiculous. So after the initial experience, everything else was just a bunch of 12-year-old kids in a heavy metal acting pretty kooky. The initial thing, I don't know. It was a strange thing. But then outside of that, yeah, I was in a Gurdjieff group for a while in San Francisco.
Yeah.
I did the work.
Oh yeah.
Who is a huge influence on rock and modern art and modern dance, actually, in a lot of another one of these.
I read about Gurdjieff through Daniel Pinchbeck's book, Breaking Open the Head, which was a huge book for me. That came out in like 2000 or 2001. It came out right after 9/11, because I think the introduction, he was like, oh, this is all, he did a little 9/11 thing. But like, God, that book is sort of a synthesis of a lot of these different ideas and how occult practices and ideas are present in popular culture and made their way. I mean, especially present in the 60s and 70s, but really, I mean, like we've touched on, I think, in this conversation a little bit, like present through certainly through all of American
history. It ebbs and flows, right? Sometimes it pierces the mainstream, you know, like... Mm-hmm. Like a great example is Jay-Z and Beyonce. Remember that a few years ago? You know, they used a lot of kind of occult symbolism in their videos and live shows. And there was a little like, oh, they're in league with Satan kind of thing. You know, not anything on the level of Marilyn Manson or Judas Priest, but there was like, there was like websites dedicated to decoding the occult imagery in their videos and stuff.
That happened with the Travis Scott concert too, where a bunch of people were killed in a crowd surge. Mm-hmm. Just a terrible, terrible fucking incident. But there was a lot of like occult and satanic iconography on stage, and I think Travis Scott as a performer and artist sort of indulges in a lot of that stuff. And yeah, it's interesting because I didn't think of it was coming from the right wing. It was actually just people on Twitter who were like, look at this. This is the devil. Travis Scott intentionally killed these people, etc. There was like this sort of thought that there's always this sort of thought, I feel like, that's present in pop culture. Like, what if it's real? What if they are really controlling us, etc.? I feel like ordinary Americans, and I know that's kind of a wide category, all will, like, if you sit them down individually and ask them about their like paranormal experiences or freaky things that have happened, everyone's got stories. Like, everyone will be like, well, it wasn't me, but my grandmother, you know, and they'll like start telling these stories. It's a through line that feels like the music connects to it, you know, like that the music is a carrier of a lot of that stuff, in part because in rock songs you can make sort of oblique references to these ideas, and everyone knows what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, and the connection to hip hop, it goes right through it too. It's funny. I think with hip hop, I think oddly enough, it sometimes gets overlooked or it has not been fully investigated yet. But you know, I was listening to Geto Boys, My Mind's Playing Tricks on Me, you know, their 1991 hit, which is really, I mean, when you think about it's a deeply spooky song. And I just don't mean like in a jokey way, like, you know, it's about war trauma and stuff, but you know, like the first verse, I mean, candles are mentioned like in the first couple of verses several times in that song. And they kind of like, you know, alone in his room with candles. And, It's a very haunted song. I mean, when we were talking about Robert Johnson and when we were talking about Tommy Johnson and the old Delta Blues, if you want to see that tradition go on in a totally different realm, I think you can hear it in a song like that, the Geto Boys. I think you can hear it in, losing track of his name, DJ Screw, another Houston tradition, which is, you know, he would slow songs down. So there you have almost like he's almost doing a back mat. Like he's almost like one of us when we were young. Cause when you hear those records backwards, it's like, ooh, you know, everyone knows that sound.
Oh yeah. It's very disorienting.
There's
something really, I always feel like something is happening. You know, what's funny is, you talk about Lynch, and he understands the power of music this way, I think, in a really intimate kind of way. And in Twin Peaks, the original Twin Peaks, the big scene where they reveal who the killer is a scene that takes place in a suburban home, and there's the only sound happening is a record player that the record is already finished, and so all you hear is this, like, ka-thum, ka-thum. And like there's something so fucked up because you know something's gonna happen, you know, that's evil in this house, and the sound of the record spinning, you know that something's wrong, you know, like there's something going on that's gonna be bad. And I don't know, there's the evil element of this as well, like that kind of like the, you know, there's the occult sort of idea in the book Season of the Witch, that's sort of this wide hippie idea, but there's also the idea of like the shit's scary as fuck, and there's like opening up there is real power to it, to me, and that's I'm one of these people that's had that feels very close to that veil, I guess, and music can be really powerful in just getting me to that.
Well, David, I'm sorry to interrupt, but you have not divulged anything on your end here. I gave you a seance story. We need something before we leave.
Well, you know what's funny is most of my experiences that have been weird or freaky have been under the influence of psychedelic drugs, which to me, like, you know, I'm a big Terrence McKenna guy, and like one of the things that he explains very well is you know, so many people would say, well, you know, if someone saw a UFO and you find out that they were on acid, does that invalidate their seeing the UFO? And for McKenna, he was like, no, that actually helps me understand that the UFO experience was real, because the acid, you know, helped sort of like reveal what was already present. And there, I feel like psychedelic drugs have always been that way for me, in the sense of like, they just show me something that was already there. And I think that's part of why I fear psychedelic drugs now. And because I had my run with them, and I've had different peaks with them over the years. But okay, two quick things, one psychedelic and one non. Like, one is my experience in October of 2010 on a big dose of LSD in Central Park in New York City. It was like a sunny day, beautiful. And at some point, like, I felt like I had this uncanny sense sitting on the grass that I was like at the front. I was riding the planet, and the planet is like a spaceship, and I was like at the front of the spaceship, sort of coursing through space. And I'm looking up at the sky, and it's broad daylight. And I don't know how else to describe it than to say that I saw the skeleton of the sky. Like, I saw the structure that was underneath it, and it was intricate, and it was made of wood. Like, it looked ancient. It had like designs in it. And, you know, if for me, a lot of people would dismiss that as, you know, some sort of vision created by the drug. But for me, it felt like I was seeing something that was always there, and that I had just noticed it, right? And I had the eyes to see it. So that's just one. And that, but the other one is just like, I don't know, my family's very haunted, dude. And like, and this is sort of the dark part of it, is that my grandfather, my mom's dad, I never met him. Everyone says I look exactly like him, though, and I have his blue eyes, etc. And that my mom says I remind her of him a lot. Anyway, he was a bad dude. And when he died at 60 years old, he left a deep imprint on the family through like hauntings. And I mean, like, both like a sort of psychological, emotional haunting that we all experience with loss, But also like just weird, freaky things happening around the house, including, when he was alive, he wouldn't let his wife, my grandma, spend more than 20 minutes on the phone. Mm-hmm. He would actually have a timer. And if she were on the phone for 20 minutes, he would come and take the phone out of her hand and hang it up. So after he died, her phone, she couldn't have a conversation on it that lasted longer than 20 minutes because the phone disconnected at exactly 20 minutes. And my dad is a telephone engineer. He went over to their house, looked at the phone, actually talked on it for longer than 20 minutes, and it didn't hang up. But then when she used the phone for 20 minutes, it wouldn't let her use it for longer than that. There are all sorts of things like that happening around the house. Eventually they had a seance. Against a lot of the family's mm-hmm. wishes, who were not into it, but they showed up anyway because grandma was sort of tortured by this. And during the seance, the person that was leading the seance asked for a sign, and a big seashell 1970s chandelier, one of those ones that hangs all the way to the ground, fell from the ceiling and shattered all over the ground. And it was so loud and so big an event that happened exactly at the time that the seance person had asked for a sign that, people would laugh at this, I think, but the people that were there at the seance, mm-hmm. it was a traumatic event for them, and continues to be something that they mention even 30 years later, right? As something that they remember and that they still think of as dad being around. So I can go on and on, and maybe we'll mm-hmm. continue with ghost stories in the in future episodes of Record Trap, because I do connect this to my own sort of journey through pop culture and music is connected to my own feeling of having, I don't know, being really, I don't know how to explain it without sounding schizophrenic, honestly. And that's, another issue, because the sort of line between occult practice and mental illness, and the way that people will dance on that line. But either way, the veil has always seemed really thin to me. I've always felt very close to my dreams and all that sort of thing. I don't have occult practices that I'm involved in, although I'm looking over at my table next to me and I have 50 decks of tarot cards that I've collected over mm-hmm. the years, just because they function for me in some sort of potent psychological way. But I don't know, I'm a believer on the other side, but I don't really have any kind of I'm like you, you know, I'm like an I don't know type of person. Ultimately, I'm not willing to say.
I also like your, I appreciate your thoughtfulness, and maybe that's a, I don't know, maybe that's a cool way to kind of wind down is, you know, I could laugh at my own experience with the seance, or, you know, I could put on a heavy metal record and joke about it. But I think it's kind of a, I don't know how I should say, there needs to be grounding when anybody ever gets into this zone and stuff, because I don't take the weird lightly. At this point in my life, I don't really, I don't mess around with too much occult stuff. I pray and meditate. And, because I've kind of mm-hmm. come to yep. a point now where I love the weird and the spooky stuff, but, for the stuff nourishing me personally, it needs to be grounded in an idea of compassion towards others. And if it doesn't have that, if it's some magical practice, with egotistical people and people just wanting to freak other people out, I'm not, closing in on 50. I'm not into that.
You're closing in on the Ren Faire world, man. Not to offend anyone that's out there into the Ren mm-hmm. the Ren Faire world, but it's a direction that I just haven't gone. In part, I feel that very, very deeply, Justin. That idea of I don't know, I'm not fucking around with magic because I'm trying to put curses on people or play with voodoo dolls or any of that shit. I love all of it. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in all of it. But in part, honestly, my practices and the things that I've been drawn to, whether it be Buddhism and reading mm-hmm. about meditation and prayer and even reading about Christianity, all of it for me has been kind, I mean, in the most individualistic sense, it's been to try to like feel better about myself and feel better about my connection to the world and other people. Like, I don't want to be corny, but like, I've dealt with a lot of anxiety in my life and a lot of like panic attacks and a lot of like feeling very uncomfortable in the world. And for me, seeking, all that sort of hippie seeking I was doing earlier in my life, and now I think I'm very much like you. I've settled into sort of like music, like specifically like playing music, the guitar, and different sort of like meditative practices. It's all about like feeling good, good vibes, being the best person I can be that can be a model for other people of how to be. And yeah, I mean, it's high-minded, but what else is there to me? I'm not trying to be like a devil worshiper that's trying to, like, I mean, for me, like, that stuff is really funny and interesting and part of the whole experience of American culture. But yeah, that's just, that's not who I am.
The power trip thing does happen in the occult. It's a very real thing. And when I became a dad, it was just like, oh, I'm interested in it, like you say, but I was like, my father haunts me, to be honest. Like, he, you know, he's like similar to,
you've mentioned this.
I needed to deal with that. And that was like, that's when I got serious. I was like, it has to be about compassion and, you know, that kind of thing. Well, so
when you think about like being haunted by the bad people in your family, it makes me think about just the whole American project is like, how many fucking ghosts are there here? You know, like, what a haunted country we are. And this is a, maybe we can end with this idea, but the whole Season of the Witch book, which was great, and I thank you for recommending it. It's called Season of the Witch, How the Occult Saved Rock and Roll, by Peter Bebergal. We enjoyed this book and enjoyed talking about it. But yeah, the idea that, that the occult is a sort of metaphor for a haunted history of this country. And in many ways, I can think of the American history as like a weird kind of occult project on its own, because there, I mean, what better metaphor is there for like control? I mean, that's exactly what those hippies in the 60s were trying to do when they were levitating the Pentagon, is meet one occult power with another occult power, which is really, really interesting. And music was so much of the language of how they understood that stuff. So this was like a mind-blowing book, a really fun conversation as always. Justin Farrar.
Oh, thank you, David.
So
it's always
we'll do another one soon.